Welcome to Legend Classes. Myself Dr. Achaya. I am going to discuss metabolic aspects of carbohydrates, proteins and lipids. Because there are some questions from previous entrances on metabolisms also. Therefore, I thought that it is better to discuss even metabolisms in brief. Nitrogenous waste material occurs inside the body. Subsequently, it results in death also. Right? This is about the urea cycle. So there is gluconeogenesis. Synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate sources in your new method. I mean synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate sources. Remember, the precursor molecules for gluconeogenesis is, one is pyruvate, lactate, glycerol 3-phosphate, a lipid molecule, alanine, an amino acid. So from amino acid, from lipid, from carbohydrate intermediates, glucose is again being synthesized. That is the reason it is called as gluconeogenesis, right? So this pyruvate, as I explained, glucose ultimately get converts into pyruvate. So the reverse of this pyruvate again yields glucose molecule, but it requires some enzymes, involvement of some shuttles, so that, because almost every reaction is a reversible reaction except reaction catalyzed by exokinase, reaction catalyzed by phosphofructokinase and pyruvate kinase. Except these three reactions in glycolysis, all are reversible in nature. Therefore, pyruvate can revert back into glucose so that it increases the glucose level in the body. This is one mode. Conversion of pyruvate into glucose. Other is lactate. There is an interconversion between pyruvate and lactate by the action of lactate dehydrogenase enzyme. Pyruvate get converted into lactate. Lactate again get converted into pyruvate. From pyruvate again it reverts back to glucose. In liver, there is a Curie-Curie cycle, Curie and Curie, Ferdinand Teresa Curie and Getty Teresa Curie, wife and husband who worked on this cycle. So, in skeletal muscles, whenever there is a strenuous exercise, it results in accumulation of lactic acid. This lactic acid simply causes muscle fatigue, means tiredness. Upon resting, again, muscle become normalizes. It means this lactic acid, again, by entering into blood circulation by means of bloodstream, it reaches the liver. In liver, where it undergoes conversion of lactate into pyruvate. Lactate again becomes pyruvate. This pyruvate again, by means of blood circulation, again it reaches glucose. This is called as Curie and Curie cycle. Finally, glycerol 3-phosphate, by getting converted into glycerol dehydrogenase 3-phosphate, again it goes back to glucose. Alanine is an amino acid. By undergoing deamination of alanine, I mean transamination, results in formation of a pyruvate. This is alanine. Once it undergoes deamination, right, it becomes CH3C(OOCOOH). It is a pyruvate. So that this results in conversion of alanine into pyruvate. Pyruvate again get reverts into glucose. This is gluconeogenesis. By different methods, non-carbohydrate moieties like alanine or glycerol, even pyruvate and lactate, intermediates of carbohydrate can become glucose. This is called as gluconeogenesis. Gluconeogenesis usually occurs in vital organs like brain, liver, testes, ovaries, kidneys, etc. This is gluconeogenesis. So calcium hydroxyapatite, calcium magnesium hydroxyapatite, it is present in the teeth for muscle contraction. Calcium ions are essential for blood clotting also. Calcium is a factor, fourth factor. It also acts as a signaling molecule. So this is about calcium. Magnesium is a cofactor for kinases, all kinases, pyruvate kinase, right, glycerokinase,
exokinase, all kinases requires magnesium. Even DNA polymerase also requires these cofactors. Sulfur. Sulfur is usually present in amino acids like cysteine, cysteine, methionine. These are the sulfur containing amino acids. So disulfide bond is essential. It is an inevitable bond for the normal functioning of proteins in a three-dimensional structure. For example, insulin hormone. Insulin hormone also possesses disulfide bond. Right, in absence of disulfide bond, proteins loses the basic three-dimensional structure. Once they lose the structure, they become non-functional. Sulfur. In addition to this, there are elements that are required less than 50 milligram. These are usually required at least 50, more than 50 milligram per day. Less than 50 milligram are called as trace elements. These are iron, chromium, manganese, molybdenum, zinc, nickel, fluorine, and iodine. So iron, this is essential for the formation of blood cells. In RBC, there is a hemoglobin protein. This hemoglobin protein is a porphyrin which requires iron as the central metal atom. So this is having four pyrrole rings. These four pyrrole rings are right, centrally they are having iron element. So this iron element is responsible for variable oxidation state so that they can bind with this one. So this is iron. Iron is essential for formation of blood. Chromium is also essential for this one, even for glucose metabolism. Right, for glucose metabolism, chromium is essential. Manganese, molybdenum. Molybdenum is essential for nitrogen fixation. Molybdenum is also. Manganese is also a cofactor for some enzymes. Zinc is a cofactor for some enzymes like carbonic anhydrase. Nickel is a cofactor for some enzymes like urease. Fluorine. This fluorine must be there in water. Right, teeth, dentine. Whatever the crown region is having this harder substance, this dentine is again surrounded by, coated by fluorine. Whenever this fluorine level exceeds more than 5 ppm, again it causes fluorosis, a problem. So it is a teratogen. Teratogen means which causes abnormality in that development. So this abnormality in case of development is called as teratogen, teratogenesis. Fluorine is one. Right, iodine. This iodine is essential for formation of thyroid hormone T3 or T4. So for this, iodine is essential. That is the reason we always go for iodized salt. Even this is essential for metamorphosis also. Thyroid iodine is essential for metabolic activities also. In addition to this, there are some other elements like tin, boron, aluminium, silicon, arsenic, etc. These are usually called as ultra trace elements. They are also essential for normal activity. Manganese is a compound which is essential for replication also. Polymerization. Nucleic acids, proteins, and carbohydrates, these are called as biopolymers. These are having polymers, many monomer units were joined together by means of a polypeptide linkage.
Lipid metabolism. So these lipids are longer chain carboxylic acids. So this R represents a hydrocarbon side chain, CH3, CH2, like this, COOH. This is a 6 carbon containing one, caprylic acid present in coconut, or for example, indicates palmitic acid, palm oil. So depending upon the number of carbons, already we had a discussion. So the type of the compound varies. So these fats, usually they enter into mitochondria, but the membrane, mitochondrial membrane is also made of lipids. It is also lipoprotein in nature. But owing to the large size, the side chain is that much larger, therefore mitochondria is impermeable for these molecules. So this mitochondria is a two membrane structure. It is having outermost membrane and innermost membrane. So for the transportation of these molecules, we require some other transporter molecule by name cornitin. Cornitin is also an amino acid derivative, lysine. Lysine amino acid, simply it is the precursor for cornitin. This cornitin transfers, this transports lipid molecules into the matrix of the mitochondria. So at this, cornitin acyl transferase enzyme comes into picture. This cornitin acyl transferase enzyme, it exists in two forms, CAT 1 and 2. Cornitin acyl transferase enzyme transports this lipid into cytoplasm. Again, this cornitin acyl transferase 2 again transfers this into outside the membrane. Once these molecules enter into the matrix of the mitochondria, they undergo beta oxidation. Every time oxidation occurs at the second carbon atom, therefore it is called as beta oxidation. Prior to this, a fatty acid molecule undergoes acylation. It accepts acetyl-CoA molecule. It is said to be acylated, or COA, palmitoyl-CoA, etc. Simply, this acylated fatty acid further undergoes dehydrogenation, removal of hydrogens. So in the first step, once they undergo dehydrogenation, the liberated hydrogens are accepted by FAD molecule. Therefore, FAD is reduced into FADH2. It is an electron acceptor. Similarly, again it undergoes hydration. It accepts a water molecule, then it becomes keto-acyl-CoA molecule. Then after, in the fourth stage, again it undergoes one more dehydrogenation. This dehydrogenation, this time these electrons are accepted by NAD molecule. NAD plus will be reduced to NADH plus H plus. So that for every one round of beta oxidation, it generates one FADH2, one NADH molecule in reduced forms. So the last reaction is called as thiolytic cleavage. So every time, for example, there is a 16 carbon containing fatty acid, upon beta oxidation it could able to generate 8 acetyl-CoA molecules, because acetyl-CoA is having 2 carbons, so that it could able to generate 8 acetyl-CoA, even number. Always remember, in animals the fatty acids are always even carbon containing, therefore, so that you can calculate these acetyl-CoA molecules that are going to be generated, but it requires only 7 rounds of beta oxidation, because every time upon oxidation it cleaves 2 carbon containing acetyl-CoA molecules. After 7 rounds, the last moiety remained is again 2 carbon containing acetyl-CoA. Therefore, it requires only 7 rounds of beta oxidation. This requires only 8 rounds of beta oxidation, so on. In case of odd carbon containing fatty acids, for example, 17 carbon or 19 carbon. In case of 17 carbon also, it generates 8 acetyl-CoA molecules, but the last compound is propionyl-CoA, 3 carbon containing. This propionyl-CoA, by accepting one more carbon dioxide in presence of biotin coenzyme, it gets converted into succinyl-CoA. This succinyl-CoA enters into TCA cycle. So that is the fate of odd number carbon containing moiety. So at last the three carbon containing CoA converts into succinyl CoA. Succinyl CoA again enters into TCA cycle. So one acetyl CoA molecule generates 12 ATPs. So you can calculate the energetics. So one acetyl CoA can generate 12 ATP molecule, so that it is easy to decipher the number of ATP molecules that are going to be generated by complete oxidation of a lipid molecule. So that this is beta oxidation. This beta oxidation also generates acetyl CoA. This acetyl CoA again condenses with oxaloacetate, results in again citric acid, isocitric, then alpha ketoglutarate, then succinyl CoA, fumarate, malate, then again oxaloacetate. This is again TCA cycle. So that ultimately either fatty acid breakdown or carbohydrate metabolism leads into acetyl CoA. So that you can say all roads leads to acetyl CoA in biochemistry. This is a popular one. All roads leads to acetyl CoA means a carbohydrate ultimately enter get converts into acetyl CoA. Lipid also enters into acetyl CoA. Even an amino acid also by undergoing deamination transamination becomes pyruvate. Pyruvate again becomes acetyl CoA, right? So these two carbon units, when an individual is having sufficient amount of energy, right, glucose, extra glucose get converts into glycogen. In case of lipid, when an individual is having sufficient amount of energy, this extra, right, even after completion of glycogenesis, because liver can accommodate only some amount of the glycogen, this extra energy, what happens? If glycolysis continues after glycogenesis, again glycolysis continues, it ultimately generates pyruvate. Pyruvate get converts into acetyl CoA. Now condensation of these acetyl CoAs ultimately results in synthesis of cholesterol. This cholesterol requires little amount of space. Cholesterol requires a little amount of space because it is hydrophobic. Again, it generates more amount of energy. That is the reason the preferred compound for storage is always lipid rather than a carbohydrate by animals. So there are even ketone bodies, acetone, beta hydroxybutyrate. These are called as ketone bodies. These are actually involved in generation of energy in the heart, because glucose, as a result of oxidation, there is a possibility for generation of lactate in case of rapid contraction. Whenever there is much demand for energy, pyruvate immediately get converts into lactate. Thereby it may result in muscle fatigue, but there is no rest for muscle cell. It never relies on glucose for energy source. Rather, it depends on these ketone bodies that generate energy. These are organic acids. Accumulation of these ketone bodies also results in acidosis, metabolic acidosis. So that once there is a change in blood pH, that is around 7.2 to 7.4, usually blood pH is in between 7.2 to 7.6, on average it comes around 7.4 neutral. Whenever there is a deviation from this blood pH, it results in acidosis. Subsequently, it results in metabolic failure. It may fatal some cases.